Distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon here from Geneva, and good morning. Good morning and good evening for some of the other participants of this event. My name is Paul Wessendorp. I'm the chief of the investment promotion section at UNCTAD, and I will be your moderator for the coming hour during this meeting. The meeting is entitled Working Together to a Global Alliance of Special Economic Zones. And we have an impressive lineup of speakers this afternoon, which you would like to welcome. Special economic zones are used by many governments as an instrument to stimulate growth, to create jobs, promote export, and build productive capacities. And for decades, UNCTAD has been supporting governments in the use of special economic zones, as well as in optimizing their development on impact. We have done that through policy advice, technical assistance, and capacity building. More recently, UNCTAD has been looking more clearly and more closely at the universe of special economic zones in its World Investment Report 2019. On the other hand, associations of investment of special economic zones also are there to support the individual zones in the many challenges that they face. In the last 1.5 years during the pandemic, we have seen the kind of difference they can make. And we have invited them this hour to speak about these particular challenges, as well as to give their insights on what this collaboration means for them, but also collaboration among each other and with organizations like UNCTAD, and to a kind of initiative that we are really discussing, the global alliance of special economic zones. And on that, I would like to give the floor to Mr. James Zahn, director of our division of investment and enterprise. James, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Paul. Distinguished the panelists. In fact, our eminent collaborators in the space of special economic zones, and also ladies, gentlemen, participants, thank you very much for participating in this important event. It's one of the highlights of the World Investment Forum 2020. We have 95 events in collaboration with over 70 international institutions. But for this topic, it's especially important, as Paul already mentioned. In fact, special economic zones are an instrument widely used to stimulate growth and create jobs and promote exports, diversifying economies and build productive capacity. So in 2019, UNCTAD undertook a global review of special economic zones in its World Investment Report to assess the impact of over 6,000 special economic zones worldwide. And these zones have been used as policy instruments, and we examined their potential contributions to sustainable development at the national and global level. And over the past decades that we have been working in this area, and indeed we see the evolution of the zones, importance of the zones. But as we enter a new era of global economy, the special economic zones are faced with a myriad of challenges, opportunities, rising from the triple mega drivers, the new industrial revolution, the sustainability imperatives, and the realignment of global economic governance and the related kind of drive for building resilient economy. So mobilizing global support for SEZ and their endeavor to attract investment for sustainable development requires a concerted effort by the SEZ community. So it is only collectively that we can be effective in modernization and policy advocacy to bring on board all stakeholders including governments, the private sectors, the international community, and foremost, the managers and administrators of the zones. So with this in mind, in 2019, I'm just talking about where this idea comes from. In 2019, when I presented our World Investment Report key findings to our Trade and Development Board and to our Investment Commission, and then later on reported to the UN General Assembly, there was unanimous support by the governments, our member states at UNCTAD and in the UN, supporting the idea of SEZ worldwide working together. So they say we need to work together. And from our perspective, we also see for the interests of the special economic zones and their associations, we need to work together. So together, we can achieve much more and we can go further. So that is why we have this idea of a kind of alliance that we called Global Alliance of Special Economic Zones, in short, GASET, so that we can work together. And we had extensive consultation and discussions before this meeting and to identify the areas of orientation for working together with a view towards a formal establishment of this global alliance, perhaps in the first half of next year. So the general orientation, I think that surfaced from our general discussion around a kind of 4 points, if I could highlight them. First, this is a global networking to facilitate cross-board and cross-industry collaboration on trade and investment promotion and facilitation. Second, as collective policy advocacy for sound enabling framework for SEZ at the national, regional, and global levels. And the third, peer learning through exchanges of experiences and best practices, including through the World Investment Forum and the many other forums that have been established by the regional and global special economic zone associations like the ones present today. The fourth is that to identify as appropriate joint programs for modernizing the zones working together. So the general idea is that we work through the associations to help zones together. So UNCTAD and SEZ associations worldwide are initiating this establishment of GASET, and the modalities of the functioning of the alliances will be further discussed with a view to formally launch the GASET in 2022, as I said, hopefully the first half of 2022. Here I would like to say that on behalf of UNCTAD Secretariat, we are very much committed to facilitating the meetings activities of this endeavor, particularly as inception stage. And I'm inviting the Special Economic Zone Associations worldwide to join as founding members. And here, I think at the presence, we have got the support from African Economic Zone Organization, Association of Clusters, Technology Parks, and SEZ of Russian Free Trade Zone Association of Latin America, International Association of Science Parks, and we have National Association of Free Trade Zone from the United States. We have the Philippines National Zone Association covering many zones, and World Free and Special Economic Zone Federation and the World Free Zone Organization. I'm just mentioning them by alphabetical order, so it's not in terms of importance, just to let you know. So these are nine associations that are coming together and have the political will to work together towards a common goal, that is to modernize the economic zones worldwide. And I hope the following discussions with the Zone Association executives will bring a fruitful outcomes and further our endeavor towards working together. Thank you. Back to you, Paul.
Thank you, James, for these introductory remarks and explaining a little bit the background of this initiative. Then I would like to give the floor to each of the associations. We have eight presentations lined up, and I'd like to start with the president of the Free Trade Zones Association of the Americas, Mr. Gustavo Gonzalez de Vega, to talk about the challenges that the membership of his association is facing, and also about this initiative. Gustavo, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Paul. And thank you very much, Mr. Yang, and your entire team of UNTAD for this invitation to share this important initiative. And of course, I would also like to greet my colleagues and friends from the rest of the regional and global association present today. I would like to begin introducing myself and our association because I am acting today as president of the board of directors of the Free Trade Zones Association of Las Americas. And first of all, I think it's necessary to briefly explain about our association to understand the relevance of special economic zones in our region. Currently, in Iberoamerica has more than 400 special economic zones that host 13,000 companies, which generate almost 1 million direct jobs in the region. Regarding sports, all these special economic zones export more than 38,000 million dollars per year. And specifically in countries like Uruguay, 31% of the sports are generated from companies within our special economic zones. In Costa Rica, 55%, and in Dominican Republic, more than 60% of the whole country exports. Finally, regarding of the GDP in our countries, in Honduras, more than 12% of the global GDP is provided by our special economic zones. For Costa Rica, 8%. Just to mention some examples, because therefore, as you appreciate, the SDCs are so important for our developing economies and constitute one of our best tools for the creation of formal employment, exports, and investment. In this context, for us, this Global Alliance initiative is extremely important for our association, in particular, when you analyze that the 25 countries of our region that we represent are developing countries. Therefore, having the support of UNTAD is the best umbrella to work together to attract investment specifically. And this is not new for us. As you know, Paul and Mr. Yang, we had worked hand by hand with UNTAD for a long time. And I would like to remark how important was that our executive director, Maria Camila Moreno, worked directly with you in the development of the World Investment Report in 2019. For us, one of the most important reports that have we writing for our special economic zones in order to attract investment. By our regional experience today, we can tell you that one of the biggest strengths of our association is to work together as a region, as we have been doing for almost 25 years, because sharing best practices always take us to a path of knowledge and prosperity. So why not make the next step, working our association globally together, our association with equal strength for attract investment for everything. And we are here today, to speak about these common challenges faced by special economic zones. Actually, we have a really short time, and I think one of the most important is what about our future. We are thinking about the next generation of special economic zones. So what kind of incentives we can offer to develop the new economy in our spaces? And this could be the concept, as Samir knows so good, Special Economic Zone 4.0, the future of special economic zones. And we think they are the ones that place their people at the center. It's something the pandemic taught us is that the people are first. The most important resource in the current economy is the human talent. So our next generation of special economic zones are the places where the people want to go to work, where the highest standards of the services to people are met. And in this line, we can assure that the special economic zones in our region are today one of the best examples of achieving of the sustainable development goals in the 2030 United Nations agenda, because we have all the tools, spaces, standards, services, security, and infrastructure. And it's for that, in a meeting as this meeting today, we want to compromise with UNTAD and our colleagues, and we'll work today and night until every special economic zone in our region compromise in a common agenda towards the accomplishment of the SDGs. Because we know that for a long time, the special economic zones have been the best ambassador to bring SDGs standards to our region. And now, more than ever, our free zones have understood that working towards the SDGs is a competitive advantage, even about the common incentives and tax advantages. And not only to attract investment, but also to guarantee the economic and social development of the territories where they are located. So what a better incentive than working for the prosperity for all by our free trade zones. So finally, as you know, the Mr. Yan, the Global Alliance was presented to the board of directors of ASFA, and the initiative was received with enthusiasm. In fact, we did a preliminary brainstorm and resulted in the following ideas. For example, to work together towards a common agenda for the accomplishment of the SDGs within our special economic zones. This could be through a roadmap, document, or guideline. Second, to generate awareness about the set of advantages of our SDGs to increase the attractiveness of investment through events, promotion, and digital marketing even. Third, to create a specific chapter every year in the World Investment Report presenting data of investment in our SDGs. And finally, why not working together with WIPA, structuring a common agenda for the promotion of investment within our special economic zone. So I finish my intervention here. I would like to speak more about it, but I'm sure we will have the opportunity soon. So finally, we want to reaffirm our commitment in this important initiative, and we are looking forward to working together in our common goals. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gustavo, for your views and also your forward-looking views on SDG zones and how they can SDGs can be ambassadors for the SDG values. Then I'd like to give the floor to Ebba Lund. She's the Chief Executive Officer of the International Association of Science Parks. Ebba.
Thank you, Paul. Hello, everybody, and thanks again also to the organizers for having us here at the World Investment Forums. I think one really gets many interesting ideas out of forums like this one. So thank you all for this great opportunity also to continue learning. And as just mentioned, I'm here representing the ISP, which is the International Association of Science Parks and Areas of Innovation. Our association currently has over 300 members in 75 countries representing 115,000 high-tech companies, like the companies located within the many different parks and areas of innovation that the ISP gathers. And all of these are strongly innovation and technology based. So it's my pleasure to share with you some of the many challenges that I think special economic zones in general and special innovation zones, as my members typically are in particular, what are the challenges? And for that, to do that efficiently and within our time frame here today, I've prepared a few notes I'd like to share with you, because the future, you could say, has already begun. In fact, the future always begins before we think of it, and often well before we are ready for it. So from the perspective of the science parks and the areas of innovation, I have just five main items I would like to share with you today. First item is that we promote innovation, and therefore we must excel also in being innovative ourselves. We need to provide new kinds of space, facilities, new and more efficient services and the like. Second item is that to do that, we also need to keep active and further expand the support of our stakeholders, especially those in the public administration and the governments. because it is public money and public money must be spent safely. And it's not also too inclined to certain risks, but we may need also to take some risks in order to innovate and test new solutions. So therefore, we need also to succeed in getting perhaps more public-private partnerships because the private sector may, and we have examples within our network, provide the amount of risk tolerance that we may need in our projects in the future. Third item, we also need to become very efficient in our advocacy endeavors. What we need from public policies and governments, it's not so much in the fiscal domain like tax exemptions, reduction, etc., but in the domain of regulations. Like, we need flexibility to be able to try out new technologies and new innovative services and solutions. And maybe the special innovation zones may be granted these more flexible regulations under of course, adequate controls. Of course, I'm also well aware that for some types of projects, special economic zones in certain regions, such measures, they are crucial. I mean the fiscal ones, but this is just not so much the case of our kind of special economic zone on whose behalf I'm speaking here today and who are more interested in the regulation issue, you could say. Fourth item, we also do need to multiply the collaboration among special economic zones, science technology parks, innovation hubs, many labels we can apply here throughout the world. And I think this can really best happen using the existing associations and networks because the companies we serve, they need as much networking as they can really get because the resources that they have, they are always limited, especially the resources of SMEs and startups. And networks here, we can say they're really formidable multipliers of resources. So establishing this line of collaboration among the associations, like the colleagues present here today, it really will help each and every one of us to do that particular job better, to also improve in turn the networking of the single economic and innovation zones. Fifth item, we also do need to make sure that the eventual restrictions in traveling and mobility, should they remain among us, that they do not mean less internationalization and more provincialism in our societies. That's another key item at a global level like ours. So, to put it in a nutshell, there are lots of challenges to be addressed, lots of innovations to be implemented, but that is also our job after all, is it not? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eba, for this intervention and also your call for more collaboration and how that could be useful to the individual associations. Now I'd like to give the floor to Mr. Ahmed Benes, Secretary General of the Africa Economic Zone Organization. Ahmed.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, James, for inviting us. And of course, I'm very pleased to be here with such fine group of representative of the economic zones across the world. And we are delighted to be among these initiatives. So the African Economic Zones Organization is the continental association leading private and public institution in charge of development and promotion management of economic zones across the African continent. We have been supporting the economic zones development in the continent for more than 6 years now, bringing together more than 80 members representing 42 countries. And through a very comprehensive action plan, we contribute to expertise sharing, capacity building, duplicating best practices, and of course, connecting with international institutions and business network. As of today, and based on this year edition of the African Economic Zones Outlook, we count 203 operational SEZ in Africa, and 73 projects have been announced for completion. Northern Africa accounts for the largest share with 29%, followed by Eastern Africa, 26%, Western Africa, 24%, Southern Africa, and then Central Africa. And the SEZ today are found in 47 countries out of the 54 economies of the continent, with the highest number in Morocco and Nigeria. One more figure is that 146,000 hectares of land has been dedicated today to the implementation of the economic zones facility, with more than 50% that has been assigned to agro-processing in Western Africa. But what is typical here in the country is that since its inception, the SEZ have given a significant boost to FDI flows, creating an attractive investment conditions and supporting job creation in the continent. And over the past 5 years, 60 million jobs have been created in agro-processing, industrial fields, services. And the SEZ in Africa have also led to export diversification, promoting regional trade and stimulating the industrial spillover effects and clustering. The SEZ also are the expression of the implementation of new industrial policies that leads to rebalance import and export activities toward a growth-based policy serving the domestic market as well as the regional demand. So in Africa, the SEZ are considered as a strategic instrument that accelerate the Africa's economic diversification that has to embrace everyone, the private sector, the public sector, women, youth, and many more. But the African SEZ also appear to have struggled for a variety of reasons. And some of the factors that are particularly specific to the zone or countries, but many are quite common to the zones programs across the continent. And factors such as the poor quality of infrastructures, poor program and management, insufficient attention to trade facilitations, challenges related to the lack of institutional coordinations and governance, and failure to integrate the zone program into a broader trade and industrial strategies. These are the main challenges that we are facing within our organizations and within the African Economic Zones community. But today, and thanks to the implementation of the African Continental Free Trade Area, which is considered as a business opportunity for us to extend our activity in promoting the intra-African trade, along with the development of this regional value chain and industrial complementarity. So we are entitled today to develop new processes for the supply chain, supporting the vision of creating one African market under this continental free trade agreement that stands for making a significant contribution to reducing trade transaction and facilitate cross-border trade. But the future of African SEZ and the success of the Global Alliance of the Special Economic Zones will also depend on decisive actions, collective efforts, and joint initiatives. So concrete policy measures, accurate data, and good key performance indicators are definitely needed to ensure that this collaborative framework could bring an effective added value to the SEZ development. So for us, who are working in the economic zones sector, we will work closely with the UNCTAD initiatives to effectively address those issues, to address the challenges, to strengthen the existing SEZ and advance the creation of new generation of economic zones within the African continent. And it becomes evident that working together in the way is the way to improve. Our contribution as African to the UNCTAD initiative is also an opportunity for us to learn from others' experience and get fresh perspective and insight into a new ways of achieving results. So within our association, we have shared the scope of these initiatives with the steering committee, and this official announcement will be made during the ISO annual meeting that will take place on the 25th of November in Accra at the African General Secretariat of the African Free Trade Agreement. Of course, the UNCTAD will be one of our main support, and we count on your contributions. And the members of these initiatives are invited also to share their expertise during this annual meeting. So through efforts, talent, resources, knowledge sharing, we can definitely affect change through this continuous cooperations between the SEZ associations, and we look forward to the success of these important initiatives. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ahmed, also on your inputs, what the Global Alliance could do and how it can make a difference. Let me now give the floor to Samir Hamrouni, Chief Executive Officer of the World Free Zones Organization. And let me remind you, we are already over time, so please be brief. Thank you very much.
Assalamu alaikum, and thank you very much, Paul and James, for this invitation, 5 to 6 minutes. I will dedicate 1 minute to introduce my organization, 4 to answer your questions of our challenges, and last half minute, some concluding remark. We are the World Fusion Organization. There are 3,000 Frisons in more than 150 countries, hosting 3 million companies, employing 100 million persons, and contributing to the third of the global trade. Today, our association, directly through Frisons and Association of Frisons, we represent the voice of 1,500 Frisons. We have members from 139 countries, and we are present through our headquarters in Dubai, United Arab Emirates, 12 regional offices, 3 in the Americas, 3 in Africa, 2 in Europe, and 3 in Asia. We strongly believe that our association, as association, we have 3 roles. One, it is to improve the day-to-day work of our members. Second, to integrate our member within their ecosystem. And third is to anticipate the future needs of our members. This is very briefly the introduction of our organization. In order to answer your question, I will share with you the result of a running project that we are developing in our organization called the Free Zone of the Future. And as, thank you very much for it, Gustavo mentioned it, Free Zone 4. And we started it in our third annual event in Cartagena de Indias, Colombia. We updated it in Dubai 2018. We piloted in 2019. In Barcelona, we couldn't implement it in 2021. Tomorrow, I will have the pleasure to give much more detail how we will implement this Frisons Board. Challenges of Frisons. We, through this project for the last 5 years, we have identified, and I will be really, really rushing, we have identified 11 challenges. Number one, Frisons should be the best place to do business. And we should improve the easy doing business of the country through service, quality of services, time frame, all the needed to be the vanguardia of easy doing business in the country. Two, we have on yearly basis to improve our contribution to the local economy, improving creating jobs, improving attractiveness of investor, and third, improving our capacity of export and integrating much more the Frisons within the, our global value chain. Third, a Frison is supposed to be a place where we have the best companies, the best technologies. We should be able to collect the knowledge, to collect that technology and to transfer it to the society. Fourth, is it not that we have that red carpet that we should be a place for illicit activity? Frison should be safe and secure for people, money, intellectual property, and goods. Fourth, Frisons should be digitally ready. Today, all our activities should be tech ready. And a Frisons should be a smart place. Whatever we have learned from smart city should be applied within the smart zone. Fourth, we have not to concentrate our effort in multinationals. We have to concentrate our offer in future multinationals. And a future multinational today is a small and medium enterprises, and a future small and medium enterprises today is a young entrepreneur. Frisons should be a place to incubate entrepreneurs and to incubate few initiatives. 75 to 80% of the Frisons companies are small and medium enterprises, and we have to give that a very special attention. The pandemic has confirmed that we need to manage our Frisons in a very innovative way. This is the only way to manage better and more efficiently the organization. Seventh, Frisons should be green and should be environmentally friendly with using in the better way, in the most efficient way, the natural resources. Tenth, a Frison should be a good place to work, a quality of job, job of quality and gender equality. 11th, and this is the last challenge, the Frisons base their attractiveness in incentives. The return of these incentives, we are understanding that it is fair, it will go to the investors and the Frison authority, but some piece and some part of this return on investment should go to the society through corporate social responsibility program. with these 11 challenges, combining these 11 challenges, and like Gustavo and Ahmed said, we will be able to face the 12th one, which is how to support and help special economic zones to contribute in a more efficient way to the social development goals. This is, in our opinion, as organization, through 5 years of research work, what are the 11 challenges of the free zones of the future plus the 12 one. As concluding remark, we are supporting this initiative. We are ready to help. We are helped to contribute to implement these indicators and these way of planning the free zone of the future to other categories of zones. You can account of us. We are ready to contribute, to implement, to host whatever needed for 2022. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Samir, for outlining all the challenges that special economic zones and their associations are facing. Let me now give the floor to Ms. Ekaterina Evdokimova. She is a member of the board of the World Free and Special Economic Zones Federation, FEMOZA. Ekaterina, the floor is yours. You're muted.
I'm sorry. Thank you very much, Paul, for the introduction. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the opportunity to participate on such a high-caratic discussion. And in order to be precise and short, I prepared a short presentation, which I would be happy to demonstrate now. Can you see my... apparently not. Let me see how to this one. Now you can probably see the presentation, right?
Yes, we see it.
Perfect. So let's go. FEMOZA was founded in December 2019, and since 2020, for the last 20 years, FEMOZA has been organizing a cooperation between the special economic zones. And now FEMOZA is advocating macro level of cooperation between the associations of the special economic zones. And I will explain in my presentation why. The challenges for the special economic zones in the post-pandemic era, they all have been named already. And I guess in this presentation, I'm just summing up what other speakers have already said today, but still. So we faced during the pandemic time, collapse of the logistic chains, dramatic freedom reduction in all countries, also in the most democratically developed countries. Huge fear of everyone for the safety, for health, for the primarily important rights. And changing of the rules, continuous changing of the rules worldwide. We saw the exponential innovation and huge digital transformation during the year 2020. We are facing now a competition for talents, not only within one country or one region, but also worldwide, globally. Companies are speaking about onshoring of their productions and about job reductions. So let's state that there is an urgent demand for collaboration and brainstorming, since nobody really knows what exactly and how exactly to make the right steps in order to bring special economic zones of the new generation to be the leaders in the industrial and economical development of their countries in the post-COVID era. So this is why FEMOZA is advocating a global alliance of the special economic zones for organizing a tighter cooperation and brainstorming and experience exchange. The post-COVID leadership in the special economic zones is a contribution for the sustainability goals. This is, in our view, says of the future is ESG, digitized, cooperative, creative, very flexible, and innovative special economic zone. We call it holistic industrial approach. And cooperation in the modern world for the special economic zones, it is an understanding of co-opetition, which is cooperation on the one side and competition on the other side, in order to improve the local situation of the special zones to become the best place for doing business. And we see different opportunities and examples for those cooperation, the vertical and the horizontal one. The vertical cooperation is a cooperation between the associations of the special economic zones. And the horizontal cooperation is a cooperation between the local, regional, and international special economic zones to share ideas and services, to share manufacturing processes. We've seen during the COVID era as a virus, a living feature was digitized. This means that in the future, each product will be digitized. And it is very probable that even the manufacturing processes will be divided into two different capacities, two different expertises, the development of the project on the one hand side and the manufacturing on the other hand side. And it is very possible that the production will become a separate expertise, and that different digitalized products will be locally produced in the countries, most hopefully in the special economic zones. So the ideas and the services of the special economic zones can be shared, and we can bring our residents a possibility to make an economy of scale within the global alliance of the special economic zones. So just to make an example, we are speaking of digitizing of the processes. Why not to share the products globally for all the special economic zones for the digitalized platforms? Why not to bring together the residents of the special economic zones to cooperate and to share manufacturing processes? But all of this needs trust, and trust is the main deficit in the 21st century. So the Global Alliance of the Special Economic Zones is an instrument, in our view, to help special economic zones and their residents to build new trust, to build a new approach to the economy of scale. Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention. And thank you for inviting us for this panel.
Thank you very much, Ekaterina, for this overview. Let me now then go to the next speakers. We got 10 minutes extra for this meeting, but still we have to be brief to give everybody a chance to speak. So let me now give the floor to Ms. Melissa Ehrman. She's the chair of the National Association of Foreign Trade Zones in the United States. Melissa, you have the floor.
Thank you, Paul. And it's my honor to represent the National Association of Foreign Trade Zones on this distinguished panel. Thank you for the invitation. And I will be brief. I am conscious of our time today.
Thank you, Melissa. So, Melissa, one second. Ekaterina, can you stop sharing your
screen? Yes, this is what I'm working out right now, how to stop sharing the screen. I'm sorry for that.
Melissa, continue, please.
Sure. So a little bit about our association. The National Association of Foreign Trade Zones represents the interests of the foreign trade zone community in the US and Puerto Rico. And we have over 700 grantees, operator user companies, and industry service providers in our association involved in this important program in the US. Our foreign trade zone program here is based on a slightly different model. And in general, special economic zones tend to be broader in scope, really, than the foreign trade zone program we have here. One of the hallmarks of our program is that we have a dual agency oversight, meaning we're regulated both by our Customs and Border Protection Agency, as well as a foreign trade zone board, which is actually within our Department of Commerce. So from the very beginning of our organization, or at the very beginning of our program here in the US, the grantees in particular are already structured to provide incentives and means of attracting investment to foreign trade zones, because they're acting as representatives of our Department of Commerce. So when we take a look at our challenges, while many of our member companies are facing much of the new economy challenges that my distinguished panelists have discussed, we as an association are primarily focused on continuing the tariff parity of our membership. And in particular, the recent challenges posed by some tariff policies here in the US have put that into a bit of a challenge. And so from a technical perspective on what we're focused on, while we do want to encourage all of our members in many of the things, embracing new economy, addressing supply chain challenges, many of the things that have already been discussed, we are also very much focused on working with our regulatory framework to ensure that our members are not put at a disadvantage because of inadvertent wording within these new tariff policies here in the US. And so we also face the challenge that we can't simply adopt changes to our program. Again, because of our structure, it does involve a much more involved process to make changes in the program and making sure that our operations can smoothly integrate into the new economy. So for us here at NAFTZ, it reminds us that zones globally have a much different structure and we're not all facing the same challenges, but there are incentives that vary by country and country, and knowledge sharing of this type and with this alliance being proposed, we think would really help our processing and thinking of new opportunities and potentially open the door for one country to adopt incentives of another for the greater benefit of the overall trading environment. And we're very much in support of that cooperation and collaboration. So again, thank you for the opportunity to talk a little bit about our program and share our enthusiasm for upcoming efforts.
Thank you very much, Melissa. And thank you for reminding us that not all zones have the same challenges. Let me then give the floor to Mr. Andre Spilenko, Director of the Association of Clusters, Technology Parks and SEZs of Russia. You have the floor, sir.
Добрый день, уважаемые друзья, уважаемый мистер Вессендорф. Спасибо за приглашение участвовать в данном мероприятии.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues, Mr. Wessendorf. Thank you for inviting our association to this event.
Наша ассоциация полностью поддерживает инициативы ЮНКТАДа по созданию глобального альянса особых экономических зон.
Our association fully supports the UNCTAD initiative to establish global alliance.
И позвольте передать слово моему коллеге, который в деталях обозначит современные вызовы, с которыми сталкиваются особые экономические зоны, и внесет предложение по механизмам решения данных вызовов. Евгений Кравченко.
Let me give the floor to my colleague, who will detail the current challenges facing CES. And make proposals of mechanism to address them. Thank you. Just a few words about our association. First slide. The Association of Cluster and Technology Parks and CES of Russia is the expert platform for the development of technology park and CES in Russia and the CIS countries. We unite more than 3,000 organizations that create 1% of countries' GDP. Next. We constantly review the practice of CES performance and identify constraints to the CES development. The association, with the support from Ministry of Economic Development of Russia, has released an English version of publication Russian Economic Zones. Currently, this publication is the only in our country that describes in detail the conditions for doing business in special economic zones. If you point your smartphone on at this QR code, our business navigator will open for you. Next slide. The association activities have long gone beyond Russia for a long time. We have been cooperating with United Nations, including UNDP and UNIDO. Within the framework of cooperation with UNIDO, we annually exchange information of development of CES in Russia and the key performance indicators. In the framework of cooperation with UNDP, the station helps to create conditions for 5 CES in Tajikistan. Our recommendations on normative legal acts are accepted by government of Tajikistan, and a wrap-up meeting will be held on 26 October to present our results of station performance in Tajikistan. So what challenges do we see for development of CES, and what solutions do we propose? First challenge, infrastructure constraints. Investors are reluctant to implement the project in the CES because of the lack of Finnish infrastructure and their reluctance to incur infrastructure costs that lengthen the project duration. So, solution, development of recommendations for best practices implementation in solving infrastructure problems. In Russia, for example, we use a mechanism to reimburse CES infrastructure costs from taxes paid by CES residents. The second challenge is the low quality of CES management responsible for attracting investors. And solution, we now plan to implement an educational program with Russian Ministry of Economic Development in 2022 for the CES management teams. We request the GESES to consider replicating this program in developing countries previously. Weak information policies. In no communication between investors and CES. The solution is to create a common informational base on exciting and emerging CES based on GESES for global cooperation between potential investors and CES. Four, weak foreign investment protection. Legislation that encourages and protects foreign investments is underdeveloped. The solution is to provide assistance to countries that develop regulations to protect and attract foreign investment. Five, lack of environmental standards. The CES strategy documents generally lack environmental policies which prevent the sustainable development of CES. And we propose the development of unified recommendations of the gases for the development of environmental standards. And last, lack of CES in developing countries. And the proposed solution is to create international project teams to create and develop CES in developing countries. Thank you for your attention. If you have any any questions and suggestions, we are ready to cooperate with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, both of you, for this presentation and lining out what the challenges of investors and SDGs are in Russia. Before we close the session, we would like to show a video by our colleague, made by Ms. Charito Plaza, the Director General of the Philippine Economic Zone Authority. And that video will be about 7 minutes.
Mr. James Yan, the director of UNCTAD's Division and Investment and Enterprise, my fellow partners on Ecozone's authorities around the world, distinguished guests, participants, ladies and gentlemen, good day. It is an honor for me today to represent the Philippines to discuss the challenges being faced by investors in the country, and to promote our economic zones as a viable location for investments even during this time. I must admit, being the head of the Philippine Economic Zone Authority, one of the leading investment promotions arm of the country, it is difficult to perform our mandate with the perilous impact of the COVID crisis. But we are not letting this paralyze us. Instead, we continue to make opportunities and platforms to continue in our duty to promote investments, create employment, generate exports, and helping in our overall efforts to bring back our booming economy. Like any other agencies or companies, PESA's registered enterprises have suffered due to the various community quarantines that restricted the usual day-to-day operations. This, however, did not stop our 4,665 registered companies located in our 417 different types of economic zones who are into manufacturing, refinery, processing, assembly, ITBPO, agro-industrial, tourism, and medical tourism to continue contributing to the global supply chain and demand and keep the economy afloat. Based on our zone reports, as of September 2021, 90 to 98% of our registered enterprises from various sectors have continued operations under various work arrangements. Some of our companies have in fact repurposed their activities to also provide support in the production of medical equipment needed by the society. As such, we were not only able to help the economy, but also protect the health, the jobs, and the livelihood of our 1.6 million direct workers and 7.6 million indirect workers. To reciprocate these acts, PESA has implemented its balancing acts to assist in the unhampered operations of our locator companies and Ecozone operators. These are the inclusion of COVID-related expenses as deductibles for enterprises availing of the 5% gross income earning incentive, and the inclusion of the ITBPO companies and economic frontline workers in the subgroup of the A4 vaccination priority list to fasten the attainment of herd immunity for the reopening of the economy. In addition to this, PEZA continues to extend the allowance of 90% work from home arrangements on the basis of the total annual revenue of the company. With the gradual reopening of the company, we are making sure that our companies adhere to the health protocols mandated by the government to minimize the spread of COVID-19. Hence, our ecozones are COVID-free and with less than 1% of the workers, thank God, who became victims of the COVID virus. Truly, there is no perfect way to combat this crisis, but we need a collective approach from all sectors to make this work. That is why PEZA's thinking global and acting local worldview, we continue to work to achieve our overarching goal of fully industrializing the Philippines and enhance the country's efficiency factors to attract more investors, such as completing the supplies and raw materials to become a big contributor to the global supply chain, the construction of more logistics and transportation hubs, creation of credit facilities from our financial, both foreign and domestic institutions for our investors, the establishment of more public works and IT infrastructures, addressing equality and a low rate of power and utilities, utilizing the idle lands of the country into different types of ecozones to attract and locate different types of industries, thus creating a production, manufacturing, digitalized, and export-driven economy, build self-reliance, self-sustaining, and resource-generating country, enhance the ease and the cost of doing business in the Philippines, making it globally competitive and an ideal investment haven in Asia. We cannot do this alone. That is why it is important for us to continue our collaborations with various stakeholders in and out of the country and attract investments that will spur a much inclusive economic recovery for the Philippines and our countrymen. The Philippines is a country blessed with rich human and natural resources. Hence, we have a lot of advantages, such as our strategic location at the center of Asia and the Pacific. We have a young global knowledge and English-speaking workforce with two types of weather and a very fertile soil, which means we can produce different types of crops and do business the whole year round. Let us make it happen in the Philippines and continue to promote galing Pinas, which means that products made in the Philippines is the best and the Philippines is best to invest in. Thank you. Mabuhay po tayong lahat. Let us strengthen our collaborations and partnership. Long live the Global Alliance of Special Economic Zones. See you again, my dear partners, and keep safe, everyone.
You are muted, Paul.
Okay. Sorry, thank you very much. And then on this celebrative note, I will give back the floor to James for some closing remarks on the way forward. James?
Thank you, Paul. Thank you very much for everyone here at the eminent panelists. And you are the leaders in the space of special economic zones. My sincere apology that I have to go downstairs to start the ministerial roundtable. We have 76 ministers speaking, including half of them are the largest economy in the world. Thankfully, I'm coming back and then to express my gratitude to all of you. My I think I try to have concluding remarks, but Ms. Plaza already had this kind of message conveyed, which is we need to work together and we have to work together. We need to focus on the 3,000 special economic zones plus 1,000 science parks and innovation areas, plus another 500 to 600 being established. This is the universe. No single organization, association can cover them. No single organization can have the full set of skills to provide a scale of support to this huge demand. It is only us working together that we can achieve such objectives. So whatever we do, whichever structure that we want to put in place, we should keep in mind that there's a demand, and that demand is not just SEZ. It's the SEZs servicing the sustainable development goals, creating jobs for people. So we think in millions, we think in hundreds of millions that what we can do for them to make our modest contribution. Now, coming back to the structure, as I said earlier, we agreed we are not establishing a new bureaucracy. We're not establishing an institution. This is a network for us to work together and to complement with each other so that when we have projects, then we join hands. When there are demands that one single association cannot make it, then we seek help for others. That is what we want to do together, and then to cover the entire universe. So that's my appeal to all of us, and also through us to the participants here. In fact, we have 4,000 formal registration here, plus in our platform back in UAE, another 10,000. This is the participants that are listening to us, and they will hear us, what we want to do collectively to help countries through the SEZ. So let's work together as a kind of a network and alliance, and UNCTAD is happy to provide a platform, to provide expertise, to facilitate all of us working together. And we are equal partners. We co-create, we co-implement, we co-advance the course of SEZ that making SEZ work for sustainable development. Thank you very much. Thank you.